Good evening and welcome to the November 21st, 2016 regularly scheduled Midland Public School Board of Education meeting. At this time, if everyone can turn off your cell phones, and I mean off, not just on vibrate, because it interferes with our TV feed, I would appreciate it. And then if you would all stand and join me in saying the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. All right, Scott, if you would take roll, please.
Absolutely. President Brandstad.
Here.
Vice President Singer.
Here.
I am here. Treasurer Wasserman.
Here.
Member Baker.
Here.
Member Frazee appears to be absent. Member Gordon.
Here.
We have a quorum.
All right, thank you. Moving on to item 2.0, which is our consent agenda. 2.1 is approval of the meeting minutes from our last meeting on October 17th. 2.2 is the following staff members have announced their resignations with effective dates. 2.3 is persons recommended for employment for this school year. 2.4 is renewal of our lynda.com subscription for 18 months. 2.5 is approval of the payment of the school system's bills for the month of September. And 2.6 are legal invoices for payment. Do I have a motion?
I move to accept consent agenda items 2.1 through 2.6.
Support.
All right, moved by Pam, supported by Jerry. Is there any discussion? All right. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed? All right, consent agenda passes. Moving into 3.0.
And our shining stars, and we're going to bring Jen's service up. She is our first recipient tonight. And I'm going to read a bunch about Jen. She can stand next to me. Jen earned her Bachelor's of Science degree from Central Michigan University in 1997 and her Master's of Arts degree from CMU in May of 2003. Ms. Service joined the Midland Public School staff in 1999 as a fourth grade classroom teacher at Longview Elementary School. Also while at Longview, she served as a member of the My Blissey leadership team. When Longview closed in 2010, Ms. Service followed the Longview students to East Lawn Elementary. While at East Lawn, Jennifer was a member of the school improvement team and steering committee. In 2014, she began her new role as the IB PYP coordinator for East Lawn and Carpenter. In this position, her main role is educating, collaborating, and supporting grade level teams as they learn the international baccalaureate standards and practices, and facilitates the creation of program of inquiry for each building. Jennifer has recently submitted the very detailed involved application for the authorization of the IB Primary Years Program for both East Lawn and Carpenter Schools and received word that the applications have been accepted. She is anticipating East Lawn and Carpenter's authorization visits in the spring. Jen was nominated for the Shining Star by an MPS colleague. Among her comments, the staff member wrote, "Jen is a constant positive presence in all that she does, as she is working to bring two schools together into the new STEM building for the upcoming school year. She's working with many new staff members to help them understand the primary years program and is mentoring them in many best practices in education. Not only is Jen a PYP leader at East Lawn and Carpenter, but she's also someone whose students know they can count on. She helps run summer school programming and goes into classrooms to help students take action with their PYP learning. Jen takes on all these roles with grace and kindness. She always has a smile on her face, encouraging words to say to her colleagues." Congratulations, Jen.
Thank you.
I remember Jen, this is all yours.
Thank you.
Thank you, especially for the long transition.
Thank you.
Thanks, Jen.
Thank you.
Congratulations. Thank you.
Our second shining star is Norm Retzloff. Norm isn't with us tonight as he is chasing what I have found to be the very elusive big whitetail deer. Let me read a little bit about Norm. Norm was hired as custodian in 1994, working at H.H. Dow High School. He left us in 1999 for a couple of years to pursue a career opportunity in the automotive field. These young men will understand that. In January of 2002, Mr. Retzloff returned to MPS as the head custodian at Adams Elementary. It was named Adams Building Manager when the positions were realigned in 2006. While at Adams, Norm's famous quote was, "Every day is a great day at Adams." Those were the words he used to bring a smile to all students, staff, parents, and visitors he met in the halls. While working full-time at Adams Elementary, Mr. Retzloff completed his associate degree in general business management from Delta College. In 2011, Norm was a recipient of the MPS Distinguished Service Award. Norm has assumed the challenging role of the Midland High Building Manager this past summer, with the retirement of his predecessor at the end of the 2015-16 school year. Norm has done a wonderful job and has hit the ground running in this very large, busy building. Norm was nominated for the Shining Star by a Midland High colleague. Among his comments were the following. In Norm's short time at Midland High School, he has made a strong impression with our students and our staff. Norm is a hard worker, and he prides himself on being productive and meeting the needs of the stakeholders in the building. His work ethic and commitment to our school have been noticed by many, but he is a humble person and certainly does not expect anything in return. Norm's no-nonsense approach and his timely response to the needs of our staff have quickly earned him a positive reputation at Midland High School. Congratulations, Norm.
Maybe you'll get some venison when you give that to him.
So, yes, congratulations to John and to Norm. All right, moving into 3.2, which is the Dow High School Auto Tech Program.
Good evening. Thank you for allowing us to speak to you this evening. Although Dow High could pick from many different things to discuss at board meetings, I did want to give an opportunity for one of our classes that maybe doesn't get the attention that it deserves, and that would be our Auto Tech program with Mr. Ransom. Mr. Ransom has been with the district, didn't ask you this, how long? About 9 years, and in that time has a great reputation as a teacher, not only from the students, but also from the staff. So I'm gonna turn it over to Mr. Ransom and the students of H.H. Dow High School, so they can talk about the Auto Tech program.
Well, good evening. Thank you again for allowing us to speak to you. And again, my name is Lance Ransom. So on this PowerPoint, I just wanted to go over in total what the Auto Tech program is, and it consists of two main parts. We have car care, which is our basic class. That is a prerequisite. Students must pass that class to move on to Auto Tech. It's one semester, 1 hour. It's a very exploratory course where we cover a lot of different subject areas in a short amount of time. Auto Tech is a 2-year program, and each class is a 2-hour block. Time. So that's kind of the format and how the classes work. Car care starting, these are all the basic areas that we cover, again, in that 1 hour, one semester time. As you can see, it's a lot of different things that we cover. First of all, obviously, it'd be safety. Everything from lab orientation to getting familiar with the shop, fire safety, we learn about OSHA, those types of things. So when the students go to work in the shop, they're familiar not only with their surroundings, but also all the safety devices they're in. That goes along with using our hoists, how to safely lift a vehicle, use floor jacks, stands, those types of things. Automotive careers, which, by the way, the Chromebooks have been fantastic. We've been able to do a lot of research with those Chromebooks, especially at this level of this class. In our shop, we typically have 3 desktops, or we did, and then 2 laptops, but now all the students have their Chromebooks, so we can do more research. Also, all of our technical manuals are based online, so all the students have everything right at their fingertips, so it's been a huge blessing. So with that research, automotive careers, vehicle identification numbers, they'll learn about how to decode on that website. Basic and specialty tools, air tools. We will also learn torches and welding. Students seem to like, you know, cutting metal with fire. So they like that. So typically what I'll do for that is we'll obviously learn how to use them, but then I'll take steel and do a demonstration, cut the steel, and then I'll weld it back together just so they can see the different processes. We have a huge section on tires, rotations. We have five different tire machines that are in the shop. They'll use all those, balance, rotate, tire pressures, all that. So it's a really substantial part of what we do. Automotive brakes, as they're doing their rotations and things, they'll learn what to look for and then how to do a basic brake inspection. And then the last four will go together as far as LOF, that's your lube oil and filter. So everything from checking suspension, steering, engines, all the different differentials and those types of things. So we do also have some time for some miscellaneous things. Like I'll usually teach the students how to change a tire on their vehicle because most of them have never done that. How to jump start a car, just the basic things that they need to know. So in a nutshell, that's car care. Auto tech is much more in depth. In the 2 years, we cover eight different areas, and it is a 2-hour block. So for year one, obviously, we start with safety. If you're picking up a theme here, obviously safety first. And essentially what safety is it's an accelerated version of what we do in car care. And then we have some more in-depth things as far as safety. Our areas would be first semester engine performance, everything from fuel systems, ignition, diagnostics, those types of things. Heating, ventilation, air conditioning, and then basic engine fundamentals will be semester one. Semester two is all brakes, ABS, traction control, disc brakes, drum brakes, everything within that semester. And then our second year, which is where we're currently at, is electrical. There's a whole lot of electrical that's integrated into vehicles now, so the entire semester is electrical. So we're building circuits, working with starting, charging, accessories, those types of things. So students are literally soldering together circuits and building the different types of circuits, and then we also apply that onto the vehicle. So it's very well-rounded. They'll learn how to use meters, test lights, all those different things, the basics that they're going to need to know to survive as an auto technician. We will finish out with suspension steering. That'll be second semester, and then a little bit of automatic and manual transmissions. So that is basically what we cover for car care and then automotive technology first and second year. Some of the program highlights, we do two car shows a year at Dow High School. Typically, we average about 30 vehicles. Most of them are student vehicles. Also, some community family members will bring vehicles. It's during both lunches, in which case we do one in the fall and then the spring as well. And then students can kind of show off what they're working on at home or in our class. And then, like I said, it's kind of neat to get the family involved as well. And then the students can kind of see what we're doing. So that's one of the neat things that we do. We also have two different competitions. Regional level, we do the Delta STS competition, where we essentially compete with other high school students and tech centers in the automotive field. We do this at Delta College in their shop, and we do a variety of different things. It's timed, and then we have a point, basically, system, and then we're placed. What's really neat is every year that we've competed, we always place, so that's pretty awesome. So we also do the MITES state level competition that we've been doing for the last 2 years. And again, it's more in depth, it's more difficult, and that's competing against all of state of Michigan. So we always hold our own, which is also really awesome. We have college credit articulation, University of Northwestern Ohio. We're currently articulating brakes and suspension steering, which is 6 credits. As of this year, Delta College, they're taking up to 24 credits as far as what we do. So the entire program, the 2-year program, will articulate with Delta College. So essentially, that's a lot of savings, and
yes,
it's an awesome opportunity for our students. So so that's a really, really neat opportunity. We are math accredited, so for that 4th year, we do obviously have math in the automotive field, and we can apply that, something that makes sense to them. And then that'll count for that 4th year math. And then also we just recertified for our NATEF certification. And essentially, if you go to a shop or dealership, their technicians are ASC certified. Those certified technicians came up with this foundation and the curriculum, and that's exactly what we teach. And that's the same at the high school and the college level. So that's why we articulate, because it's whatever they learn with me is what they would learn at the college level as well. So that's why we can have those awesome, you know, articulation opportunities. Just had a couple slides here. This is one of the car shows. A couple of our students, we have everything from cars, trucks, motorcycles, snowmobiles. And then at Dow High, we line up around the cafeteria in the concourse area. Typically, like I said, average about 30 vehicles. These are a couple of my current students. This is actually Chase's dad's Harley Panhead, and then Mitch, that's his bike as well. So we just have a variety of different things. Everything from the 30s all the way up to 2016 is kind of the range of what we have. So, yeah, so it's really neat. These are some students. Last year, when they compete, this was for the STS competition. They usually get certificates. So this was the group that I took. We always do pictures, and then there's certificates. The MITES competition, they actually get scholarships. A lot of the surrounding tech schools will be at MITES, and then in their placements, they're typically there with scholarship opportunities as well. So MITES is a neat opportunity again as well. Just a couple shots of our shop. We are 5 bays wide and 2 deep, and we are essentially a fully functional repair facility. We have up-to-date equipment in general, diagnostic equipment, electrical equipment. We're continuing to grow and build all the different tools and things that we have. So the students have really helped me keep that shop organized, clean. We take a lot of pride in the shop and what we do. This is actually one of the computer desks that my former student built. He was taking auto tech with me. He was taking wood shop and welding. So it was neat to kind of incorporate all three of those together. And then he built this, the bottom sections of wood, and then the top part is actually exhaust pipe and camshafts that he welded together. And then the welding program did the sign with the plasma cam over at Midland High. So so that is kind of our center meeting point and where we can get onto that, to the all data, which is our online database that we have. This is one of the things that I forgot to mention. Highlights was our open lab. Every other week, we use a 2-hour block where the students can come and work on their own vehicles for that 2-hour time. And then I am also obviously an ASE certified technician, so not only teaching them, but I can help them with their own vehicles, and we work on a variety of different things. So this is actually one of our students, Bailey. It's working with the tire machines, and I'd like you to notice that he does have his safety glasses on. So. Another pair of students just working in the shop. The shop is usually completely full. We pack the shop, and we have a variety of different things going on. Students working from bay to bay, tire machines, welding, just doing a lot of different neat things, and it's on their own vehicles. The other neat thing is we are getting more and more girls interested in the program. My car care, my basic class, I have about 9 girls in that class, and it's continuing to grow. I'm averaging about 30 students in the car care class, so it's exploding. And auto tech is maintaining in the, you know, 20 to low 20s, so it's doing very well, so we're very thankful for that. This is just a shot of the classroom that's attached to the shop. So what we learn here, we can go right outside our door and then apply to our shop, which is connected. So, okay, each student has a slide, and what I did was I interviewed them and then put in a slide what they had to say. So I was going to turn it over to them on the 4 slides, and then if you have questions, feel free.
Okay, so I like this program because it has hands-on work and you get to work on things. And it's taught me not to give up if I don't know what to do, or it's taught me to ask questions if I don't know. And it's taught me to push myself to something that I can't do. So if I think I can't do something, it's taught me to ask questions and learn. And my plan after high school is become a mechanical engineer and work on engines specifically.
I like the automotive program because I enjoy learning about automobiles and I enjoy learning new things. And taking this class has improved my basic skills with vehicles, and it showed me a lot of different ways to do things. The automotive program is a very laid-back program, but it has strict rules that are really fair. And I like that there's so much to learn and always ask, or always help when you ask for it. I'm not really sure on my plans after high school, but I'm sure I'll incorporate the automotive program in them.
So, name's Tristan. I chose the automotive program to learn more in depth of like how to do things on vehicles. I was raised in a family how to work on cars, stuff like that, but I want to learn more in depth of things. I just think the program is like very well taught and it's super easy to learn, and I just, you know, it's such a great class. And honestly, like, this class helped me, like, it improved my grades, like, throughout every class, English, math, all that, just because, like, I have it first and second hour, and it just helps me wake up and get in through the day, and just helps out entirely. My plans after high school is I'm going to college to get my bachelor's degree, and I don't know necessarily what I want to do, but I'm going to go to Delta for the GM automotive program, and then the after that, I'm going to go into the welding program and get certified in both of them.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Joshua Strike. I'm a sophomore this year, and I chose the automotive program because it offered me what I had an interest in, because ever since I was little, I have always been interested in, like, the mechanical aspect of engines, like how they work, what makes them work, why they work, and I've heard from a lot of friends that were in the class. I heard that was a really good class. I'm like, all right, I'll try it out. And I took car care, the prerequisite, and it was a great class. I'm like, you know what? I'm going to take the auto tech and both years, and I'm loving it so far. And I like the hands-on aspect and, like, being able to learn how to do something, like in the classroom, like Mr. Ransom said, was saying. I like learning it on paper. And then being able to go out in the class and put that, use the sheet and actually make it work and make it happen. And it makes me excited to come to school because it's a class that I really enjoy to do. And it's my fifth and sixth hour, and that's my class. It gives me time to like unwind and actually learn about something I'm very interested in. And my plans after high school is to start at like an oil change or a tire repair shop, and then hopefully work my way up to be a master technician.
Wow. We allowed to ask questions?
Very good.
Fire away. First of all, thanks for coming. Okay. And this isn't for you guys yet, but for everybody else here, this is what STEM is all about. Okay, this is hands-on learning, project-based learning. So for people wondering where we're headed with things, this is a kind of a microcosm in one little special area. A couple of questions. How many of your, to Mr. Ransom, how many of your auto care students move on to the auto tech program?
I would say, percentage-wise,
yeah.
I'd say 80 to 90%.
Really that high?
Yeah.
Okay.
What did you say? 80?
80 to
90.
Wow, that's pretty good.
Yep.
Yeah,
sorry about that.
That's okay.
And I got a series of that.
Go ahead.
Okay.
Go ahead.
Go for it.
I may have missed it. Again, to Mr. Ransom, no engine or fuel injection area of study. Did I miss it?
Oh, absolutely. Yes. Engine performance is a major area that has to do with fuel injection. Yes. We don't really cover carburetors or anything, but all the way up to direct injection.
So you have to go back to the 1930s when Mike was a kid.
Yeah, right.
I've rebuilt a few carburetors.
And for each of you, you kind of said where you wanted to go, and I'm trying to remember each of you. You talk about mechanical engineering. I heard someone talk about wants to be get a certified welder. What's your thinking behind all that? What makes you want to do each of those?
It's kind of just like a hands-on thing. Like, I grew up around mechanical stuff, and it's just something that I'm interested in.
Okay.
I don't know necessarily what I want to do yet, but I can weld good, and I can work on cars good. So I just want to be able to fall back. Like, let's say I get a decent job here, but it crashes, and then I'm still certified in welding, or I'm still certified as an automotive technician, so I still have that trade to fall back on.
Mm-hmm. Excellent. You won't go wrong with the welding. That's all I'll say. That's all I had.
I've got a question for any of the students. Have you come in and had a problem that you struggled with solving, and if so, what was one of those problems and how did you solve it?
Working on a car or a motorcycle? Open lab, it gives you 2 hours to work on your own thing and use the shop, like the hoist, the tire machines, and like all the tools in the shop. And there's actually a really good organized section of like checking out the tools and all that stuff. So it's organized to go back, grab a tool, come back, work on your car. But I've worked on my truck multiple times inside there and fixed certain things that I couldn't have fixed at home, like being able to use the hoist and lift it up. So I'd have to crawl around on the ground.
Okay. Have you used your teacher's expertise then and helping?
Yeah, he's always running around like a chicken with his head chopped off. Because, you know, there's the tire machine, there's the hoist, there's people welding, there's people cutting stuff, using the bead blaster. You know, he's always running around checking, make sure everything's okay and answering questions, everything like that. Very busy.
Did you ever have one of those aha moments, like, oh, that's what it was?
Or yeah, all the time.
All the time.
Daily. You know, like, the biggest aha moments, like, when you're in the class, and you're like, well, how does this work? And then, like, you have the picture in front of you or whatever, like, the paperwork that we're working on, and you take it out to, like, for instance, of mine, you take out the, like, we're doing a combination circuit lab. You take it out to the breadboard, and you have the wires in your hand, you have the light bulbs in your hand, you build it, and do all that stuff. Is just so much easier than just sitting in front of them and just getting taught everything on a piece of paper,
right,
and actually being able to take it out to the classroom.
Very good. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Has any of this experience translated into summer jobs, internships, stuff like that? And if so, can you tell us a little bit about it? Gage, I see you nodding your head.
Yeah. I actually have a job waiting for me at GM and Ford.
Fantastic.
For when I graduate, but I don't know necessarily what I'm going to go into, because we had an instance with Ford not too long ago. But
so were they on campus interviewing, or how did that get connected there?
Well, actually, one of our car shows, one of the reps from the local Ford dealer came, and they were looking for they're in need of technicians. I mean, really in this area especially, and they've been telling me that constantly. So they're basically recruiting. We're working on possibly co-op and those types of things so that we can get the students out while they're still in high school as well, as well as afterwards. But the car show was a good point of contact for us.
So I was going to say, that may lead into my question. I was going to ask, so the two of you that are sophomores, so next year you'll take the second, then what do you do your senior year if you want to continue this? So would the co-oping be... Do you already have something established, or is that something you're looking at establishing?
In some cases, students, if they can fit it in their schedule, I've had students come back for even a third year of auto tech. And
oh, okay.
Because I do have students that will take car care their freshman year, and then they're in auto tech their sophomore year. And so I have had students come back. They, you know, even though it's a rotation of the curriculum, they've had it, but they will come back. But we are looking to possibly work that time into possibly a co-op situation or something like that.
Do you have any contact with any former students to know where some of them might be and what they're doing?
Actually, one of the requirements for NATEF, our certification, is to keep tabs on students, see what they're doing. So as we just went through the NATEF certification process last year, I was able to make contact with several students, and the majority of them were working in their field. Some of them are in the military, but typically when they go in the military, they're typically doing some type of mechanical field or welding. Those two are really kind of the hot items with my students anyway. So yes, absolutely.
We were talking before the meeting about having the Chromebooks. Want to elaborate a little bit about how you guys like having that technology in your hands versus before that?
Well, like, there's a website, it's called All Data, and it's very helpful to use that website, because a lot of times, even cars in class, you're going to torque down a bolt with a torque wrench, and you don't know how tight it has to be, so you go on All Data and you look it up, and it tells you exactly how many foot-pounds it has to be torqued down to, so that way you don't over torque it. And I mean, there's tons of applications that it's used for. You can find out specifications, like how much oil your car will hold, tons of things. Tons of, it's very useful.
Are the vehicles that you work on mainly derived from your own, or do you take them from outside sources?
We basically have our own fleet that has been donated over the years, and we do take vehicles. Also, now that we have the new NATEF certification, believe it or not, the manufacturers are starting to look into donating so we can get some newer vehicles. So basically, it is a donation type of situation. But we do have, our students typically will bring their vehicles as well. So not just open lab, but if we're doing a lab on curriculum, like for example, right now we're doing charging, I can have the students use a tool to do a load test for the alternator. They can bring their vehicle around and do the lab. As long as it's directly related, they can do it on their own vehicle. Open lab is, we do just about everything, but if it's electrically or curriculum specific, they can use their own vehicle. So okay. plenty of things to work on.
In fact, we, correct me if I'm wrong on this, Lance, we donated one of the old superintendent's cars at one time.
Yep.
Old Chevy. Since I don't drive a school car, it went out to them.
I was going to ask about the grammar. Is the old an adjective describing the superintendent, yeah, or an old describing the vehicle?
They wouldn't want to work on my 300,000 mile or so.
To the students, I'm assuming the competitions you're in, and I may be wrong on this assumption, are to diagnose a problem and to discern and solve a problem. Is that fair?
I'll step in. These students here, we have not.
They have not gone yet.
Right.
Okay.
So
never mind.
Last, yeah.
Never mind.
But
okay.
But yes, it is a lot, okay, of diagnosis. Absolutely.
Okay. I'll hold off the question then because they couldn't answer it.
They'll have to come back next year.
Yeah, you have to come back. Mr. Ransom, one question for you.
Yes.
And maybe you don't want to share this. You're obviously very competent in this field, yet you've chosen to teach the field.
Mm-hmm.
Why do you enjoy the teaching?
It's amazing to pass your passion on to the next generation. Fixing cars for a living was a good experience because I don't teach these guys out of a textbook. I teach from doing it 8 hours a day. So, but I just really felt a calling to pass my passion on to the next generation. And there's really not much of anything more fulfilling than what I do, and I think all teachers will say that. But I can have a student that will, for example, know nothing about brakes, and by the end of the semester, I mean, they can make their own repairs and save themselves, you know, $70, $80, $100 an hour, and they can make a living doing it and then apply that to grow as far as their career. So I felt the calling to teach instead of continue to do it, just for those reasons.
Well, we'll say it for everybody else. Well, thank you for making that choice.
Yeah, thank you so much.
We are very lucky you made that choice.
Yep. Any other comments?
Thank you for coming.
Thank you, guys.
Best of luck to all of you.
Yes,
you
indeed.
Continue on in your education. All right, moving on to Board of Education matters. So, Bob. One exciting thing to another.
I know. I'm going to get a complex. It happens every meeting.
Yeah, I talked to him before. I told
Thanks
him
for
how
coming,
most
you guys.
People leave at this
Thank
point.
You.
Thank you. Come on, tax collection. Where are you guys going?
I'm not going to read the resolution.
Yeah, not as exciting as putting together a car.
Thanks so much.
What you have in front of you is an annual process for us. It's the summer tax collection request. As you know, it's a legal requirement of the board to take formal action prior to January 1, that we intend to collect taxes in the summer. The middle public schools, we collect summer taxes in property within the city only. The townships, property outside, but in the district, and the townships are levied in December. And so if you approve it, a copy of the signed resolution goes to the city manager, and also a copy is attached to these minutes.
I'll read it. Okay. I move to approve the resolution for the collection of the 2017 summer taxes. A complete copy of the resolution shall be attached to the original of these minutes.
Support.
All right. Moved by Scott, supported by Jerry. Is there any discussion?
If we were to vote no, does that mean they wouldn't collect the taxes? I've always wondered about some of these votes we take.
We'll bring them back to you.
Yeah, they would come back in the next meeting, Jerry.
That's the only question I asked.
Is this a roll call?
No, this is not a roll call. All right. All those in favor, say aye.
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 All those opposed? All right. Motion passes. All right. Moving into 4.2. Back to you, Bob.
Okay. The second piece of business we have tonight is our property and casualty insurance, which we do annually at this time in November. We did bid it out this year to seven different insurance. insurance agencies, and we got responses from three. We are asking you to approve the low bidder, Yoder Insurance Company, who is also the group that we've been with in the past. A couple different things. You'll notice that the amount of property and content, what it's listed at, if you had a memory to last year, it's down a little bit. Well, that's because we've taken down a couple of buildings, but we're also building one. And like it says in your agenda, the Central Park Elementary not included under that amount because it's currently covered under a builder's risk policy until it's completed. And then it would switch over onto our tax or our property and would have to be insured at that time. Same will happen as ongoing, just to keep you in mind as we touch each of these elementary schools, that same kind of process. And we put additions onto them, the value will change and we'll have those kinds of things that are happening as we go. Yeah, it was the low bidder. The total cost comes in at $188,996.25, and we're recommending that we approve that.
All right, do I have a motion?
I move to approve item 4.2, the property and casualty insurance with the EITER.
Second.
All right, moved by Pam, seconded by Scott. Is there any discussion on this?
I was happy to have a local business supported in this.
Bob, this is fair. Should I ask this question beforehand to be a little more prepared because it's a detailed question. Do you know how much we draw on this insurance every year? What our claim experience has been?
I couldn't tell you off the top of my head. I'm always amazed that there'll be a certain portion and I'll go, do we really need that? And they'll say, oh, by the way, you filed a claim on that one. I wouldn't say it's an outstanding number. I think we've had a pretty good risk history, but there's always some area it happens at that we've drawn from that I couldn't tell you. I mean, we could do some research, but I couldn't tell you off the top. We're relatively claim free, but we have them, and they run the gamut of different things.
Gotcha. Thank you.
Any other discussion? All right. All those in favor, say aye.
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 All those opposed? All right. Motion passes. Moving into 4.3, Mike.
So it's our semi-annual NEOLA updates to our policies, and these were all revisions to policies. No new policy. Usually revisions are driven by federal or state law regulation changes, so we kind of have to do them anyway. It's just a matter of technicality. So we review those policy with our agency, and then they come to you for approval. And so you have quite a few of them there for approval.
All right, motion.
I move adoption of the NEOLA policies as in agenda item 4.3.
Support. Okay.
All right, moved by Jerry, supported by Pam. Is there any discussion? All right, all those in favor say aye.
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 All those opposed? All right, passes. Next up, item 5 is a request to address the board. Do we have anyone who would like to address the board tonight? Thank you. You would state your name and address. Is that?
Yeah, that's fine.
I don't know. It is.
Yes, yep. Sure. Fantastic.
My name is Matthew Vanette. I'm at 603 Coolidge Drive. I have two questions. Last week at the city council meeting, there was a presentation regarding Curie Golf Course and where it stands, and one of the aspects that they were pushing is youth golf. And a question was raised there about sending information home to the students in the schools, or with the students in the schools. And at that time, the city manager said the schools don't allow outside groups to solicit. Is that correct?
I can answer that for you. Okay. We do, but we do not send home paper copies anymore. And so we have a spot on our website that we allow outside flyers for youth organizations to advertise to our parents.
That doesn't mesh with what actually is happening, though. Because I'm getting paper copies home from lacrosse, karate. We get information about who else?
Lacrosse, karate, robotics.
Robotics,
yeah.
Scouts. Lots of organizations are sending.
Those are school partnerships, so there's a definition we use on those. I don't have the exact definition, but lacrosse would be a club that affiliates into our programs, and so sometimes those get flyers home. Robotics is obviously ours, and so it's a partnership that we have with ours. So there's some shirt-tail relationship to the school district on those. Just other programs that have no relationships, go on the website.
Okay. We don't have a golf team, or do we, at high schools?
We have high school golf teams. This, what you're talking about, we have no information
okay.
on. So you're
well, nobody, it seems nobody has any information about it, so
yeah,
I'm just curious.
No one has came okay. to us about any information
okay.
about youth golf.
And then the second thing, there were letters that were sent home regarding truancy and attendance. Are you familiar with these?
I am.
Okay. How was it decided which students or parents received those?
The letter that you're referring to, I believe, went home to all parents. It was written by the Judge Allen?
I don't know because we didn't get one.
Okay. I know there was some youth letters sent home provided by the court system to us to go home, and I believe it went to all parents, but I could check into that.
Okay. Thank you.
You bet.
Great. At this time, do we have anyone else who would like to address the board? All right. Moving into item 6.0, curriculum, instruction, and assessment. And I guess, Pam, you are reading.
I do have the minutes.
Minutes first tonight.
Yes, we met on October 17th. And we talked about third grade reading legislation. Luann Bensinger provided an overview of the new third grade reading legislation. The new law calls for retention of third grade students that are not reading at grade level. The law will affect students that are currently in kindergarten. Luann also discussed preliminary MPS plans to provide deeper interventions for kindergarten through third grade students in need of reading assistance. A recent grant authored by Luann will bring approximately $80,000 to Midland Public Schools to provide literacy assessment resources, classroom library enhancements, and individual tutoring time for struggling readers provided by MPS instructors. The next thing that was discussed is the Midland High School Math Performance Initiative. Midland High School has implemented a multifaceted plan aimed at reducing the achievement gap and increasing overall proficiency in mathematics. Measures include scheduling all ninth grade students in at least 0.2 algebra courses, providing a learning coach for math teachers, and enhanced professional development supports. Connie Beeson-Steger and Jeff Jaster presented details on achievement data, internal support structures, and intended outcomes of the initiative. We adjourned by 3:30, and their remaining CIA meeting dates are every month.
All right, thank you very much. Moving on to FFO. So I guess we had no minutes because we would have read them at the last meeting, and then we just spent
so no minutes to, since we just met. But I do have for you, for informational purposes, 7.1 and 7.2. 7.1, it is 25 different gifts, totaling $23,078.92. 25 is a lot, but I'll point out to you, I really want you to notice, don't forget at the end of our board meetings, we run the whole list of everybody, but take a look at the various donors. Mm-hmm. This is like, the who's who of everyone we get, from parents donating money to our programs, to the PTOs associated with schools, to outside organizations, to some of the familiar ones like booster clubs, mm-hmm. To the Midland Community Foundation. You'll see a lot and will continue to see for the nonviolence activities that they were so generous to give. The typically community gives, where our teams are out there typically earning money based on doing things for the community in a charitable way. I mean, this time I think really shows you everything, outside businesses that have given money. So 25 would be a lot to read, but I would just point out to you that we do publish those in the agenda, and also at the end of our board meeting, we run all those on there. And it's an impressive amount. It's what you like to see, is the 23,000 and 25 different donors. So, you know, a lot of people out there giving money as they see for lots of reasons. That's the other thing that's interesting too, from some of the STEM and robotics to supplies to particular sports or activities that they want to help support in their schools. 7.2 is a donation. We get those from time to time. This one was from Great Lakes Safety Training Center to our building trades program. You'll notice there was a power saw and table, four platform ladders, extension cords, and of course work gloves and safety glasses, which of course we always appreciate greatly in all those programs. So once again, this month, the community and families and businesses out there have been very generous to us.
Awesome. Thank you very much to all the donors. I too, when I was reading the agenda before, was just wowed by the number of different people and organizations that have donated to our schools. And it's one of the things that makes our schools so special is the support that we got. All right. Moving into human resources, study committee minutes. Do you have minutes to read, Scott?
I do have some. Very brief, but they're here.
All right.
Our meeting was held Wednesday, October 5th at 11 a.m. Present were myself, Pat Verzee, Pam Singer, Mike Sherrow, and Cynthia Marchese. We discussed briefly a pending lawsuit. We were updated on an MCEA grievance that has advanced to arbitration. And as far as staffing goes, we got an update of our new hires after the teacher retirements and vacancies that we had gone through. Our next meeting date is scheduled presently for Wednesday, December 7th, 2016 at 4:30 p.m.
We have several families to recognize for, and have lost loved ones. We have Miss Virginia Sears, who passed away on October 19th. Miss Sears was a teacher at Sugnet School for 20 years, retiring in 1980. Miss Sears was a recipient of the Gerstacker Award for Excellence in Teaching in 1968. Miss Mary Lewis Trumbull, who passed away on October 19th. Miss Trumbull was an MPS paraprofessional for 10 years, working with special education students at Adams and Longview. Miss Trumbull retired in 2008. Miss Jill Short, who passed away on October 22nd. Miss Short was a paraprofessional at Chippewassee and Midland High for 20 years, retiring in 2007. Miss Margaret Graves, who passed away on October 25th. Miss Graves was a teacher at Central for 23 years, retiring in 1989. And Miss Gwendolyn Phillips, who passed away on November 11th. Miss Phillips was an elementary teacher for 33 years at Siebert Woodcrest Elementary Schools. Ms. Phillips retired in 2002. You want me to go on?
Sure.
Item 8.3, we have two members who have announced their retirements. Rosemary Dubay, a paraprofessional at H.H. Dow High School, will retire on November 21st. Right?
Today.
That's today. So I had to think about that for a minute. Suzanne Story, Office Paraprofessional Northeast, April 1st, 2017.
All right. So our thoughts to the former staff members who have passed.
Yeah, that was quite the list.
All right. At this time, moving into correspondence to the Board of Education, there's a list of letters from the Board of Education. And then after that, scheduled activities. Just to be aware, our next meeting will be December 19th, 2016, and all meetings after that will be voted on at our January 16th organizational meeting. At this time, we'll move into study discussion section. The first thing that I have, given that we are approaching the end of the year, at this time we always, amongst the Board of Education, we vote on the nominating committee. So that's three members of our board who will work to establish the slate for officers for next year. So at this time, I will pass these out. If you can please vote on three. Actually, I can just send them this way, can I?
Yeah.
And then Cindy, if we put them up here, can you? Thank you. Thank you. right, at this time, we'll move into hearing from our board members. Lynn, let's start with you.
First, I want to thank Auto Tech class for coming again. It's just, to me, it's so exciting to see kids so passionate about what they're studying and what they're learning about and how they'll apply it in some way to their future, whether it's in their future career or just to have that knowledge that they can use on a day-to-day life. So they did a great job, and I'm always amazed at how poised and how well they get up and they speak in front of a crowd like this. So, and to their teacher, Lance Ransom, he's obviously doing a fantastic job and is very highly respected by his students. Congratulations to Dow High and Midland High for their drama productions. They always do an amazing job as well, and their teachers and their coaches and their families that support them through all this. It's fun to go see all that talent there. And then, thank you to the so many schools and the students have been collecting food and having penny drives, and to me it's just really a neat thing to see kids starting so young to be concerned and giving and generous to help others that are in need. And they're starting this at such a young age, and hopefully will be a lifelong important activity to them. And to Jen and Norm, thank you for all that you do. And lastly, happy Thanksgiving.
Mm-hmm. Well, me next.
Yes.
I also enjoyed the presentation this evening. It's always so great to see the students come in and just see their enthusiasm for what they're doing. That's so great. It was great to get the feedback on how they're using the Chromebooks. Mm-hmm. That was one of my favorite things that we did. So that was great to hear that. And it's nice to know that we have so many different things going on, too. So that's good. I wanted to say that I thought it was very nice that you, Mr. Cheryl, placed such an emphasis on being thankful and the things we have to be thankful for, because we really do. It's easy to lose sight of those things, but in your letter today. So I just thought that was very nice, and happy Thanksgiving, everyone.
Lose my voice. I just want to wish everybody a safe and happy Thanksgiving. I will be spending my time reflecting on life and appreciating friends and family.
That's deep.
And so I hope everybody gets a chance to do that and at least appreciate the blessings that we have. So that's all I had.
Very good. I certainly enjoyed the presentation tonight, and anytime there's hands-on learning, it gets me more excited about STEM and our initiative and pushing forward. Reminds me about our Project Lead the Way as well in the elementary schools and how that's wrapped around having a problem, solving the problem, and leading the way to learning through that inquiry and solving problems. So I'm very excited as that moves forward and teachers continue to get training, and can hardly wait to see that full blown at Central Park Elementary and then roll into the other elementaries after that. I heard Central Park Elementary is completely closed in, so that is exciting. And I also look forward to the next steps that we take for creating safer school entrances at several of the elementary schools. So, and happy Thanksgiving.
I'll start with that. Happy Thanksgiving, safe travels, as Scott said. Everybody come back, all our students and staff. And I'd like to, at this point, thank all of our stellar educators. And just what spurred that was the personification by Mr. Ransom here tonight. Mm-hmm. His dedication is shared by many of our teachers, and it was just interesting to see his motivations and wanting to pass something on, mm-hmm. that being his knowledge and expertise and enthusiasm. And congratulations to Mary Friedel and Brad Blasey for their election. I see Mary's here tonight. I don't see Brad. But I wish them well in securing mm-hmm. the district's future as we go forward.
Excellent. All right. Well, I think I reiterate what everyone else has said. I really enjoyed the Auto Tech program. A couple of us talked to them for a while before. And it's so great to see such passion, and excited that we offer programs like that can ignite that passion. And I know I certainly appreciate people who can fix my car.
So, you're not kidding.
Yeah, I know exactly. Even though I'm in the auto industry, I still appreciate others who can do that. If people took some time today to read the Monday communique. I think people have referenced it. It's amazing. A lot of times it's two pages. Today's went on to a third. There's just so much going on in the district, and it's so exciting to read about it. And if anyone's watching out there, we will send that communique to anyone who would like it. So if you don't receive that, just contact, you know, Cindy, and she will make sure you get on the distribution list, because it's always exciting to see everything going on in the district, everything that people are involved in. Congratulations to Jen and Norm on their shining stars, too. Very deserving individuals. I know Jen has presented before here, and you can see her passion for education. And we had Norm at Adams the whole time my children were there, so I know his dedication to what he does. And lastly, I missed the meeting last time because I was at the Midland Dow Girls Swim Meet, and just another example. It's senior night. They do it for both schools, and it's always such an exciting time to be there. Not only is it the meet between the two schools, but they honor all the seniors both at the same time, and they make it a very special event for both schools. So that's always a good thing. And happy Thanksgiving to everybody. And I guess at this time I will read the nominating committee. So the nominating committee, we will meet sometime in December, will be Lynn, Pam, and myself. All right, and I will turn it over to you, Mike.
Well, auto technicians are near and dear to my heart, but if you guys remember my background.
Well, I wondered if you had been over to help them and show them a thing or
two. I probably should go over and see how they're doing, but I was raised in that industry, and family was in that business for 50-some years, and I think it was just 5 years ago, I finally let my certification expire, figuring I must be safe. I'm getting close to that 30-year mark. I'll never have to go back and work on cars. So that is now expired. But I still work on my own car, so we're still doing some of that. Back to school business. Office of Civil Rights is working with school districts throughout the state, if you've been following on website compliance. And so this is something new, and it's just a matter of when it's your turn. And so most of us are not fully in compliant. In fact, I don't know of anybody that is. And so they're working with you. They're not out finding you or doing anything with those. They're trying to get you compliant. We've tried to get ahead of the game, and I sent you a letter as far as Dave working with technician staff and maybe getting an outside agency to review our website, tell us what we can do. But this is going to be quite a long process for schools to come into full compliance. You think about all the links to things off our site, who also needs to be compliant at some point in time. So lots to do there. I imagine at some point we'll be contacted by the Office of Civil Rights as well on that.
Mike, is this the Federal Department of Education or the state?
Started on the west side, and it's the state. Okay. And so you start with a complaint, and they began to realize that, you know, schools, because of their nature, have probably never fully complied, and so we will be compliant. May cost us some dollars because some of the software and stuff that we need to be fully compliant. I sent you a list on construction timelines, and there's, I don't want to say we're in a slow period because there's 70-some contractors working at Central Park, but we are on the finishing up the design phases of all the secure entries for all the buildings and the work to be done at Plymouth Woodcrest for their full reconstruction. Those will be going out to bid in December, and you'll be taking action in January to award those bids. So moving quick, all the construction secure entries in Plymouth and Woodcrest will start on April. So it's a pretty lengthy timeline. We're ready to go on taking on some other work as Central Park begins to wind down a little bit as well. So we're getting very close to Central Park, completely closed in, all windows. For the most, the roofing's completely on. There's a few spots they still have to touch up on the roofing, but we are closed in before any winter weather. When we walked through the other day, 95% of the cement flooring's in place. I can imagine maybe by today it's probably all put in place. Daryl didn't mention that earlier today, but I'm not sure it would be. November 29, am I saying that right? November 29, we have what we're calling a community leaders group that we're gonna take through. We've been taking quite a few tours of groups. We've taken, you know, our own staffing, we've taken parents, we're taking teachers, and now we're on to a communities leaders group. We'll continue to take different groups of people so they get a chance to see it a little bit ahead of time. You're starting to get the feel for the building. Even since you were in 2 or 3 weeks ago, it looks completely different. So you're getting a really nice feel for it. We took our full administrative staff through the other day. Many of them said, wow, just blown away. I couldn't imagine. I tried a picture in my head, but it's different than the picture. And then, of course, some of them said, can't help being a little bit envious of that nice new school and what it's going to look like. But I remind everybody, lots of new things for the other buildings coming as well when we get there. So MDE accountability scorecard, so a new scorecard for schools, has been released to us, but not for public consumption yet. As Brian met with the CIA earlier in today, he promised them next month he was going to give them a full rundown on that report card. He actually was ready today, but we ran out of time. You know, it fares like we always have, where we're a high-performing school district and performing very well compared to our counterparts. It does show, once again, that we have this gap, large gap, between our bottom 30% and top 30%. So that's been around for a while, where they take the bottom 30 of your performance and your bottom 30 performance, and they measure the gap in between. It makes you kind of focus on a group that you need to bring up along. And so we still have a lot of work to do with that bottom 30%. Some of those gaps are caused because of our high being so high, but it doesn't matter. We still have to work with that bottom 30%. Many of our at-risk students are in that bottom 30%. So some work to do, more to come. Brian will work with the CIA committee as he goes forward with that piece of it. Tomorrow we have a session with our MCA Teacher Leadership Committee. We're going to share them some financial data with them in preparations to open negotiations here very soon. And so going to show them what our forecast is, and it's a forecast, even this year. So we're going to forecast 2 years out kind of what we expect to happen with enrollment and financial trends. And obviously there's a lot of variables in there. You know, with legislators, we're not really sure what's going to occur with our financing. Student enrollment is certainly still a volatile for us, but we can get a prediction and see if we can't jumpstart that negotiation process. We had a good negotiation last time. We hope to have even better this time as we go forward. A little better financial position to be doing some talking. So, lame duck. So as we know, we're in a lame duck session. And if you recall, the last time we were in lame duck, more school legislation got passed in a matter of 48 hours than probably the entire year of legislation action. So we have some fear of that. You know, we really hate to see our legislators take actions on things that are happening in 24, 48 hours. There's a couple of hot topics in Lansing, and one of them is MPSRS reform. And tending to be a conservative guy myself, you would think I would be all for that, but I'm really not on this one. And I think that our public needs to be careful on this one. Our governor put in some reform 3 or 4 years ago, maybe 5 years ago now, that appears to be working. And he is against this legislation as well. So him and his party are a little bit at odds on this. His reforms have begun to work, and the pension system's about 80% funded. As you know, all new employees are treated different than old guys like I. But what they really would like to do right now, the talk is to close the MPSR function fully down. And the danger to us is that would take a very large payment to fund that and close it down. And you know where that payment's going to come from. It's going to come from some of the general fund, but it's also going to come from the school aid fund. And so what would that do to us at a time where we're finally stabilizing our finances to have a big chunk paid into that piece of it? So, you know, I tend to agree with the governor on this one. Let's let those reforms work. See if we can't come fully fund it, be so closing that down. The other side of that is, you know, our profession has taken a beating for 4 or 5 years. It's tough to attract highly qualified, intelligent people into the profession at this point in time. Certainly closing a retirement system down and giving them a much different retirement for new employees would make that even more difficult. We're heading for a teacher shortage as it is. We know, we even saw some of that this summer when we had to recruit 50-some teachers. Even though we're still a place that teachers want to go to, it was difficult to do. So I think it's something we've got to keep talking to our legislators. Be ready, because I'm probably going to send you some alerts that I need you to be talking to them as we go heading forward. Bravo. Most of you are familiar with our Bravo, our volunteer system. It's kind of become a bit overwhelming because we approve more applicants than we've ever had. We use a state system. Yvonne's probably aware of it, the iChat system, and it's not the easiest system to work into, to go through, so it takes quite a bit of time. We fall behind at times in the schools. Adult school buildings have had to suffer at times that we haven't processed them fast enough. Plus, we have so many volunteers who want to volunteer in our school system, we need to organize them a little better than we've done. And Central Park's a perfect example where we're looking to actually get many volunteers to help us educate those students in those STEM spaces. And without organizing that, it's going to be more chaos than help. And so we've been talking for a while with United Way. They get volunteers often for us. And Ann has gone and talked with Dow Chemical Company, who is willing to do a matching grant with us of $20,000 to work on updating, supplying some manpower, recruiting, organizing our volunteer process. So we're going to be working with them as we go forward. If you see Rob Valentin or Ann Fillmore, make sure you say thank you, because I think this is a real good step and another great example of a community partner stepping in to help the school district as we go forward. New board members. Jerry mentioned that we have two new board members. We've met and orientated them somewhat, what you can do in an orientation for an hour or two before you actually get your feet wet. And obviously, we've encouraged them to sign up for MASB classes and get them up to speed as quick as we can. We're already including them on all board communications that go out to make sure they're up to speed on that piece of it. And please spread the word on joining the Famous Names in STEM. Our fundraising efforts with the Midland Community Foundation on our outdoor learning spaces, I think we're about halfway there. But this is the time of year that really pushes. You know, we're all coming up on tax season, closing another tax year, and we're all looking for write-offs that you can. A 2-to-1 match. So every dollar you give, it really is $3, and you get your name recognized forever in those spaces. And so I know my wife and I will be doing it, and I encourage you, but also to encourage friends to do so.
All right, thank you. Does anyone else have anything? All right.